again this week, we have been confronted with an experience of unfathomable evil and terror. The worst in U.S. history, according to the media, although I would add a caveat, outside of war. It seems like it's been happening a lot more in recent years. In fact, one article in the paper that I saw this week enumerated about a dozen since the turn of the 21st century. Is it happening more, or are we simply becoming more aware of it in the age of instant communication and worldwide communication? I suspect it's probably both, because evil has a way of feeding on itself, and even multiplying itself. Nevertheless, we are continually shocked and grieved. One of the Christian commentators that I follow, I find him to be a deeply thoughtful man and very articulate, is Dr. Albert Moeller. Among the things that he said this week was this: why would anyone kill a fellow human being? Why launch an ambush massacre upon concertgoers listening to country music? Why premeditate a mass killing? Was he driven by some obsession? Fueled by some grievance? Was he sending a signal or political message as an act of terrorism? Is the answer psychiatric or pharmacological? Our minds crave an answer. Why do we ask why? We cannot help but ask why, because made in God's image, we are moral creatures who cannot grasp or understand the world around us without moral categories. We are moral creatures inhabiting a moral universe, and our moral sense of meaning is the faculty most perplexed when overwhelmed by horror or grief. I am very aware that these kinds of events can strike a parish such as St. Peter's in a particularly poignant way, having experienced that kind of senseless evil within our common life not so very long ago. And no doubt the experience of this last week has probably brought back to many of us a real sense of empathy for those who were on the scene and personally experiencing those events last Sunday evening. I also do not doubt that some of us feel like we have been set a couple of steps back in that ongoing healing process that we have been on for the last several years and have come so far. How does one heal in a lasting way? I think of all those events over years since the turn of the current century, there have been two that have really stood out as showing a particularly Christian answer to that question of how one heals. One was the slaughter of the Amish children in their schoolhouse some years ago, and the other was the mass killing at the church in Charleston, South Carolina. And in both cases, the people in those Christian communities who claimed the name of Christ showed the power of their faith during the most difficult of circumstances by forgiving the perpetrators. Absolutely incredible. And yet it is forgiveness that is such an important element in bringing lasting healing into the lives of those who have been hurt. The last few Sundays, our theme has been on forgiveness. The Old Testament and the Gospel lessons are really turn continues to invite us, especially in view of the events of last week, to think a little bit more about this issue of forgiveness. And I'd like to offer three things about the whole role of forgiveness in terms of healing that I hope will be helpful to us. First, I think the power of forgiveness comes from the fact that it is so very personal. It is exactly the person or the people who have been hurt that are the ones who are called on to forgive. It is a hard thing, to be sure, but we have the example of Christ himself. Because forgiveness involves a willingness to accept the pain. A willingness to accept the pain. And the best example of that that I can think of is Christ on the cross. At the moment that he is being nailed in his hands and in his feet, crying out and saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Forgiveness is powerful because it is universal. Secondly, forgiveness does not deny evil or sin in the world. In fact, it acknowledges it and even calls it out. We think of the church's first martyr, Stephen, following in the footsteps of Jesus Christ, while he is being stoned, crying out, "O God, do not hold this sin against them." He acknowledges that this is an evil thing that is happening. But nonetheless, in the face of that, he offers forgiveness to those who are perpetrating that evil against him. The spirit of forgiveness is not taken in by a kind of Pollyannish, human beings are basically good after all kind of approach. A forgiving spirit acknowledges the fact that fallen human beings are capable of both great good and great evil. But in either case, we are talking about people who are ultimately made in the image of God and are people for whom Christ died. And so, forgiveness is able to allow justice to be served. But it allows that justice to be served by giving the state and the courts their proper role, so that it is in fact justice that is served in the end and not vengeance. It allows the vengeance to be let go of, trusting that justice will be served. It is an important part of being able to forgive. Nor does forgiveness deny our ability or even our responsibility to try to change those conditions that might lead to such an event. And so to try to thwart the perpetration of evil in the future. In fact, that is part of the whole picture, too. As the community as a whole begins to look at the whole thing and decide, what can we do? What needs to happen to try to keep this kind of thing from happening again? But all the while, the ones who are hurt, the ones most in need of healing, are then free to let go of vengeance. Finally, I think that a spirit of forgiveness has its power not only because it is personal, not only because it can because it allows us not to be enslaved to a past that cannot change. And that's where I think we can draw insight from our epistle lesson today. Because toward the end of that passage, Paul says, "This one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus." Now, certainly for Paul, that moving on was not moving on from hurts that others perpetrated against him in this particular case, so much as leaving behind his own sins that he knew that God had forgiven. Not being enslaved by his guilt over his persecution of Christ's church, but moving on to the upward call of God in Christ that had been given to him in his conversion. But it also works just as surely for those of us who have been hurt by others. It is in forgiving that we are saying we will not be enslaved by this experience. We will not allow that hurt to just control us for the rest of our lives. We will let go and give it over to God, and we will move on. And I think that's the encouragement that is there for us today, to think about the importance of forgiveness and the process of healing and to understand that it is a way not only to release the other, but to release ourselves as well from enslavement to a path that cannot be changed. But it also frees us to move forward in Christ to pursue greater justice within the world, to pursue creating those kind of conditions by which evil can be more effectively thwarted in the future. It can free us to help heal others in their hurt. And it frees us to move forward, trusting in the grace and the power of God that to be at work in the all, to heal the sense and soul, and to deliver to you I pray that this may be true for all of us today who bear the name of Christ, that at the hard times we will be willing to do the hard things and so find the grace of that forgiveness and healing. Thank you.